thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Okay, folks, Chair Paisley is detained in traffic, and so we'll get started with the November 18th, 2024.
Alamance County Board of Commissioners meeting, and Chair Paisley has the, I have the Pledge of Allegiance and the invocation, so if you will join me in prayer. Father God, as we come together, dear Lord, we come together to do the business of the folks of Alamance County, and we just lift up our community, lift up our citizens, and ask you to be with us, ask you to guide the deliberations of this board, that they will be acceptable not only in your sight, dear Lord, but in the folks that live with us, the folks in our county. We ask you to keep us safe as we head home from here tonight, give us wonderful deliberations, and just bless us as you have mightily blessed us in the past. We ask all this, dear Father, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. Join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay. Do we have a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Any changes? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Passes unanimously. Okay.
Steve, could I ask a question? If there's a like a special guest in the audience that we want to recognize, do we do that at the end or do we do it with public comments? Or, I mean, there's not going to be no speech. It's just to acknowledge somebody's here.
Probably normally that would be during public comments, I would think.
Okay. Well, what if they're young and they may want to go home?
And have a bedtime is what you're saying. Well, why don't we look at adding that between the public comments and the consent agenda? Will
great.
That work?
That's okay. Great. Thank you.
Okay, folks, public comments. We have 9 people signed up, and one, I think, is withdrawn, so 8. The comment period, folks, is 30 minutes. I've incorrectly informed, I checked with the county attorney, and I incorrectly informed some folks earlier that only 3 could speak on an issue. That's an old policy. We've changed that policy. It's just a limit on the total amount of time for public comments. So I apologize for the error there. So I'll get started. Lee Hicks,
is he in
the room?
Steve, remember there's a 3-minute time limit per person as
well. Right, there's a limit to 3 minutes per speaker, 30 minutes total for the speeches. So, Mr. Hicks?
Last time I was here, it was a
good evening. My name is Lee Hicks, and I live at 950 Border Lake Trail in Burlington, North Carolina. I'm here tonight to speak about the Rad Gun Range located on Jim Barnwell Road. From my home, the gun range is approximately 0.7 miles away. I want to make it clear that I did not move into this community recently, nor am I here today as someone trying to change the character of a neighborhood I just arrived in. I have lived in this area for nearly 25 years. In this community, which is made up of residential homes, farms, and churches, was once a peaceful place. But now with the gun range operating here, it is being forced to change. And unfortunately, that change has not been positive for the people who live here. From the start, there has been a lack of respect for our community, but I don't need to go into every instance of that disrespect. There are enough people here tonight who can share their own personal experiences. However, I do feel it is important to highlight a few of the concerns that have directly impacted my family and my neighbors. For years, I have contacted the Alamance County Sheriff's Office to report the ongoing noise issues from the gun range. The shooting happens 7 days a week, often into the evening, and many times well past sunset. It's not just shooting. There have been multiple instances of loud explosions, including binary explosives, which rattle our homes and disrupt our lives. Just last week, as I returned home from work, I experienced three separate explosions, each one so powerful it rattled the pictures on my walls. My border collie was terrified. She ran and hid in fear. I even had to purchase a GPS tracking collar for her because she often bolts when the explosions and gunfire start. I want you to understand how constant and intrusive the noise is. Last week, I was laying in the bed with the television on around 8:30 p.m. when the noise started again. I contacted the sheriff's office, and just as a few may have seen, I recorded a video and posted it to social media. I want everyone to hear for themselves what we're living with on a daily basis. The constant sound of gunfire and explosions has made our once peaceful neighborhood feel like a war zone. Most of you may not fully understand what we're going through because you don't live here. You haven't had to endure this constant disruption. We're a community that has always been welcoming to new neighbors, but it's hard to maintain that spirit when someone comes into our community, shows no regard for the well-being of the people who already live here. When that happens, it forces change that none of us ask for. I'm asking for your help tonight. I'm not just speaking for myself, but for the many neighbors who are suffering the same way. We want to see a solution, one that allows us to restore the peace and quality of life we once had. This isn't just about noise. This is about our homes, our families, and our quality of life. I urge you to take this seriously and look into ways to address these concerns. We deserve the peace and quiet that our homes, farms, and churches once provided. And we hope this board can work together to find a solution that respects everyone involved. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Hicks. Reverend Tommy Fargus, if I say that right?
Yes, sir. My name is Tommy Fargus. I'm the pastor of Deep Creek Baptist Church, 1753 Deep Creek Church Road. I also live on 1907 Deep Creek Church Road. I'm blessed to be right across the pasture from our good friends at the Rad Range. As a church that began in 1935 there in the community, we've always respected the neighborhood. I have people that when we have problems, when we think there's drug dealing going on or different things, they'll come to me. And I'll go to the sheriff, and he handles it. But this Rad Range, I've talked with the owner. I had to look his name up because I honestly just call him a liar because of how he yields to tell the truth to me. Rudy Cortese, he was running for public office, and then he wanted to be real nice. And I said, there's no way I could vote for you. He said, why not? I said, you all disrespect this neighborhood. Not only that, it's dangerous. We're trying to conduct service on Sundays, Sunday night, Wednesday night. We have revivals. We have special services. We have funerals. Lord help if we have a funeral and there's someone that had committed suicide and you're standing out at the grave and have to hear a war zone. I have a man in our church that fought in Vietnam. He lost most of his platoon. He has a Purple Heart and a Bronze Star. This man told me one day as he was standing at the front door of the church right after service, and he said, you know what? It brings back memories of Nam. He said, that's hurtful. And I could see the agony in his face. And I've spoke with the owner multiple times, and he's been dishonest multiple times. He said, what would please y'all? He said, what's the biggest deal? I said, well, the biggest thing is it disrespects the fine folks in this neighborhood. They didn't move into your neighborhood. You moved into ours. And I said, I don't care about all this grandfathered mess. It's a shooting range in what's basically now a residential neighborhood. We might as well face facts. It's not country anymore like it used to be. And he promised me on two different occasions. He said, we'll stop shooting then on Sunday mornings till after your service. And if you have a funeral or something else going on, we'll stop shooting for that too. That lasted 1 week. 1 week. I don't take lightly being lied to because as pastor of Deep Creek Baptist Church, I represent Jesus Christ. That church is a church of our holy God. And when you lying to me, you're lying to God. And he's disrespected us. It's a shame when our grandchildren can't even stand that play outside anymore. I have a grandson that has a small amount of autism. He can't even be out in the yard anymore when the shooting's going on. He covers his ears and he cries. Folks, this is ridiculous. This is the United States of America. And it's time for us to take a stand and say, enough's enough. You don't move into somebody's
neighborhood. I'm sorry, sir, but your time is now
up. My time's up.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Butch McKenzie.
Mind if I give y'all some paperwork? Let's see here.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
County attorney want one?
Sure.
My name is Butch McKenzie. I live at 2750 White Swan Drive. My property is about 30 yards from where they shoot high-powered rifles. If you would refer to number one on your sheet there, this is a 50 caliber bullet that was pulled out of Allison's bedroom wall. If you turn the page.
I'm sorry, I beg your pardon, pulled out of what?
This is a 50 caliber bullet that came out of the Allison's bedroom wall, shot by the gun on the next page. The gun called the neighbor hater. On the back of number one is the sheriff's report of the rifle being used to shoot the gun, and it went into the Allison's home. If you look at number two, this is the elevated berm in the front yard of the gun range. If you notice, the berms are way below the rifles. They set their targets on top of the berm. When they shoot high, they're aiming directly at the Allison's house, which the bullet went into. If you turn the next page on number two, you'll see how much higher the rifles are than the dirt berms are. Now, I'm sitting out in my car on Fawcett Lane. Any car going down Fawcett Lane could be shot if they turn the gun or mishandle the gun. If you look at number three, these are the guns they're renting to the general public. Get 50 shots for $105, 50 rounds for $90. Is this even legal? Is the general public qualified to be shooting these guns? If you look at number four, see that no trespassing sign? We put those up on Howard Dunn's property to try to keep the gun range off of his property. Well, the gun range, Rudy, took all the no trespassing signs down and removed them. We wanted the shooters to know that they were shooting on someone else's property, but Rudy took the signs down. If you look on the next page, you'll see this. The sheriff and I were just out there two Wednesdays ago. You see the fresh bullet hole in one of Mr. Dunn's trees. Literally thousands of bullets are shooting into his trees. They're mowing the forest down. They're shooting down trees. Look on the last page of number four, and you see more trees that have been shot up and shot down. The tops are missing on them. If you look at number five, there's your man right there who's selling Tannerite. All these explosions are from the Tannerite he's selling that shakes our homes, cracks our concrete, rattles our windows. If you look on the next page of number five, there he is talking about shooting the automatic weapons. Who knows who's shooting those things and if they're qualified. If you look on the number five on the back page, the fire that was started by the Rad Gun Range and the fire report. This is more, our lives are more important. You got to listen to this. If you look at number 7, the last page, then we'll skip the alcohol consumption.
I'm sorry, but you're out of time.
Here is the rules on the very last page for North Carolina gun ranges. 200 feet from property lines, 1,320 feet away from occupied dwellings. We need some laws to be enforced that already exist. I would like to say that we went to mediation and agreed to pay half the fee to have a gun range professional see if they could make that a safe gun range. Rudy Cartasi refused. He would not let us make it a safe one.
Okay, Steve Barker.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Can you make it?
Nope. Mine is minor compared to these, but it's still a problem. I'm Steve Barker. I live at 6515.
Excuse me, Mr. Barker, could we wait a moment and give the chair a chance to get settled? You want to back his time up?
Thank you, Bruce. You get in okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks, sir.
I have agreed to allow Pam to do a recognition after public comments before the consent agenda comes up. And here's and we're on Steve Barker here now.
Yeah.
And okay, Mr. Barker.
And Mr. Barker, before you start, I apologize. I got stopped by an ambulance on Webb Avenue, and they blocked the entire universe off. So I finally got here, and I apologize. Go ahead, please, sir.
I'm Steve Barker. I live at 6515 Pagetown Road. I've already sent emails, a detailed letter to all the county commissioners. I gave them copies again tonight, and I copied Sheriff Terry Johnson concerning very disturbing gunshots along Pagetown Road, northwest Alamance County. Some of my neighbors here are also here, and we're concerned with the noise and safety, high-powered firearms at a property modified into a practice gun shooting range. As many as 4 other individuals are arriving to shoot weapons along with the property owner. The owner, Gomez Emmanuel Garcia, bought a 1.3-acre property next to mine at 6515 Pagetown Road, which includes the road during the spring of this year. The property is recently for sale by him, to my knowledge. The property has no well electricity and was found not suitable for septic, dated 6/20/24. The first gunshots occurred at night, to my knowledge, September, about 9:30, 10 o'clock at night. I eventually called the sheriff's department since it lasted about 30 minutes or more. There have been about 3 other shooting events at the Garcia property since September, and I believe law enforcement has been called by each time. November the 9th, 2024 was the highest volume shooting event. I estimate over 1,000 rounds were shot. My windows vibrated, and I believe the loud noises from gunshot caused temporary damage to my TV satellite for 36 hours. There were no weather issues that could have caused this. I have proof of tree shots on my property, going over the property line onto my property. This is my sister's and mine. The property is shallow in depth. It isn't suitable for high-powered weapons because it's less than 1,000 feet. Garcia and his friends are shooting downhill onto my property and hitting my trees. And when investigated by myself, I found gunshots on trees further to the north affecting my storage building and possibly my home. I resent the gunfire crossing onto my property and possibly my home storage building. I've given copies of the sound ordinance. The sound ordinance, you know, it promotes public health, comfort, safety, and the welfare of the Alamance County citizens.
And we thank you, sir.
Well, I got most of it.
Is it James Walker or Waller? Yeah, I think it's Waller. State your name, please, sir.
My name is James Walker. I'm a resident at 2418 Miss Blanchard Road. I came here this evening to let you guys know that I have livestock on our property, and the loud explosions and the consistent gunfire, it is just absolutely annoying. And our horses, you know, with those explosions, the gunshots, I guess they've gotten used to it over the time, but those explosions, we've had several instances of them busting out of the fence, you know, having to track them down. I work sometimes in Greensboro and having to get calls from neighbors and stuff to come try to get my livestock handled back in and everything. It's just been a nuisance. So would love for you guys to see about doing something about that, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Like Hudson
Faulkner,
possibly. I apologize, but it's your handwriting.
Yeah, it is. My name is Hudson Faulkner. I live at 2449 Mrs. Blanchard Road. Like others have said, our houses shake. I was in my shop Saturday when they had tannerite explosions. My whole shop shakes, my doors shake. I have cracked concrete, which I believe is from that. It was at one time a peaceful neighborhood. I'm the sixth generation to live on our road. And I would like for it to keep going, but because of this range, no. Why would you want to live there? Your house shakes, your dogs and animals run off. It's just, we've went from local, everybody's, you know, happy, great community, to our biggest issue fighting 24 hours a day is this gun range. Before I came here, just competitive, repetitive machine gun fires on the way here tonight. I just think something's got to change. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Looks like Hudson Faulkner. Oh, I'm sorry.
Now, I told Scott that we have a limit of three on one issue. He might want to speak now.
Yeah, I'd like to speak. It's okay.
All right. Mark Turkey.
No, no.
Terry?
Shot.
Oh, he said, okay.
Who's next? Hey, go ahead.
Go ahead. He was marked out on the list.
Yeah, I marked it out because he told me the three.
All right.
So my name is Scott Sharp. I live at 1873 Jim Barmel Road. I'm going to pivot from what I had planned because I don't want to lay more soil on top of a grave that's already set a firm foundation here. We started out with a prayer, and I thought that was very good. When we pray at home, we hear gunshots. When our grandkids are here, we hear gunshots. When we try to sleep during the day because we might have to work at night, we hear gunshots. Now, I was in the military, so I'm a proud veteran. I believe in the Second Amendment. I believe many of the people at the gun range are great people trying to protect themselves. But the laws of nuisance, which it's been since the 80s, since I've been in college, does not worry about grandfather clauses. It worries about what's happening. It's a nuisance. We've tried to be good partners. Matter of fact, this is not the only business that's been there. There's been restaurants there. There's been a church there. We partnered with that businesses. We've mowed their yard before. We baled their hay. We fixed the fences. We can't partner with this one. We're struggling. We feel that we have no help. We don't know what to do. We can't let our kids play. We know ricochets are happening. We can hear them. They go over our head. He won't claim it. We can't defend it because we can't find it. I'm asking you to understand that there may not be laws that govern his grandfather clause, but there are laws for public and private nuisances that should be addressed, because I've been told in business you should attack opportunities before they can become problems. This is an opportunity that I'm afraid is going to turn into a problem, so much so that maybe an animal will get killed, a human may get killed, because shrapnel doesn't care. It just is going to find where it's going to find. And I appreciate your time, and I hope you listen to the foundations that we put forward and not just think we're complaining residents. We're just trying to protect what may happen if we don't do something about this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Looks like Mark Terry.
Hey, good evening, everybody. My name is Mark Terry. I'm a resident of Alamance County for 8 years. I moved here from Durham County. You can imagine the transition that could take. I've been a tenant of one of you commissioners for the last 8 years that I've actually lived here. Recently, my wife, Tori, and I purchased a property. We purchased it in northwest Alamance County. We knew our friend, Butch. We've known him for 8 years. We've watched him live peacefully out there, and we wanted to be a part of that community. We loved it out there. We purchased a piece of property out there a year ago, knowing what was going on across the street, with hopes that someone within power and someone with knowledge and laws and the ability to uphold laws could make changes for this. I want to go back to what the last gentleman said, too. I heard in your prayer two very distinct things. I was raised in a Christian household on a dairy farm, guys. All right, I know about gunshots going off in the woods, occasional gunshots. I heard you guys ask for prayers for the community, and I heard you ask for prayers for safety. I got to tell you something. My wife and I purchased this property, which is 2528 Fawcett Lane. If any of you live in a neighborhood, it's the old scary cabin sitting right across from the gun range, all right? It ain't going to be scary no more. It's 1935. It's been around as long as anything out there. Original owners of Fawcett lived there. It's a Fawcett property, okay? And I just cannot, for the fathom of me, my wife and I work out there on the weekends trying to improve this property. Okay, we have moved wood. We have moved trash. We have moved things. We have cleared that lot and made it better for your community. Can I hear that? 10-4. All right. You know what scares the hell out of me? My wife mowing grass in the front yard, and I can see muzzle blasts coming off of that long range. I can see the blast off of it. I can feel it in my chest. And to have the thought of her out there on a lawnmower mowing that lawn and fearful for her life and mine scares the hell out of me. And you guys have the opportunity to do something about this. Do any of you guys do your own lawn work? Do y'all plant flower beds? Do you do leaf work? Do you rake? Do you have to do any of that with earplugs in to gain some kind of sanity? I'm going to close this with one more thing. My friend Butch, who I've known for 8 years, laid back, cool as a cucumber. You know what I've never seen? I've never seen him more agitated and irritated during the day and in the evenings when he's walking around trying to talk to us like this, because the concussion is affecting his mental capabilities and his health. I thank every one of you guys for giving me the opportunity to speak tonight, and I will finish with this. My wife and I are both concealed weapon permit carriers, and we both support the Second Amendment. We do not support infringements on our rights, though. Thank you.
Henry Vines, and as Henry is coming up, county commissioners have a comment period at the end of the meeting. And I guarantee I will have a comment about this issue at the end of the meeting. But we aren't able to address speakers at this point. Yes, sir.
My name is Henry Vines. I live at 3450 Isley Drive in Snow Camp. Just wanted to congratulate all our re-elected officials, Commissioner Thompson, I'm sorry, and Mr. Paisley, and our newly elected Commissioner, Mr. Ed Priola. I wanted to take that opportunity to welcome you. And wanted to just thank each and every one of you for your service that you've given us. And tonight I would just like to say thank you to Mr. Bill Ashley. Your expertise and finances and stuff has been a huge asset to this county and to this board. And it is going to be sorely missed. And I will miss you as a friend and as a commissioner. Mr. Turner, it's bittersweet for you. I hate to see you leave, but I wish you all the best in your new endeavor as judge. I think you'll be a good and fair man, and I really appreciate everything you've done for this county. Mr. Carter, you know, I always appreciate whatever you do. Commissioner Thompson, I keep telling you Thomas. I'd like to thank you for having the faith and trust in me to appoint me to the Board of Equalization. I can't say that it hadn't been a challenge, because during that reval, there were some very difficult times, but I learned a lot, and I appreciate you having the confidence in me to let me do this on your behalf. So saying that, you know, I would also like to say that I'd like to wish every one of you a happy Thanksgiving. We have so much to be thankful for in this country. And all of us, I think, here, we don't have to go to bed at night hungry because, you know, of us farmers. I'm a farmer. And just like to make a short comment about what's been said here tonight. And all of you know, for years, I have wanted something done about planning or zoning, that ugly word. These are things that could have been addressed many years ago so that maybe we didn't run into these issues. We need to look forward as we go forward in trying to do something to protect from things like this happening. Stuff coming into communities, into farmland, into farmers, you know, in my area, the rock quarry. Gentlemen and ladies, we need something done. And we appreciate your help on that. Wish each and every one of you the best. And if we don't see you before, wish you a happy new year, too. Thank you.
Thank you, Henry.
Might also indicate Henry's on the planning board, and I have talked to him about this issue prior to tonight. Okay, consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
Since Commissioner Thompson had someone she
just
wanted
a second.
To acknowledge before right. The consent agenda.
Please,
ma'am. James Allegretto, I can't never pronounce his name correctly, he'll kill me, called me about you three gentlemen, and he told me that Mr. Paul Newberry was going to be here. And anytime I can get young men, in front of an audience that are doing something really amazing, I'm going to always acknowledge you. So I'm going to let Mr. Newberry stand up and talk about these three amazing young people they are and what's all the stuff on their uniforms. And embarrass them. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Paul Newberry. I'm with Troop 9. We're right down the road. Tonight I've got three scouts with me. Our senior patrol leader, Kai, Tenderfoot Aiden, and Tenderfoot Levi. They're all three working on their citizenship in the community merit badge. That's an Eagle-required merit badge. As part of that, they are required to attend either a city council meeting or a county commissioner's meeting. And since I've been here before and spoken in front of y'all many years ago, I figured this was the best place to come. They have to write about an issue, and I think we had a really good issue tonight, so they'll be writing about that and turning that in. For two of them, that's their last requirement, and then they'll get their merit badge. For Kai, he's going to be working on that while he's abroad. He's getting ready to leave us to go off with his mother and father to, you tell me where you, all over the place. She's a professor at Elon University.
Awesome.
Thank you guys for your time.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, thank you. That'll be one thing that you will remember your entire life. I am an Eagle Scout and Order of the Arrow. And I even put that on my campaign materials running for this office. So be proud of what you're doing. Thank you.
Okay, motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second. Do we have a second? Have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Unanimous. Thank you. And guys, you're welcome to sit through the entire meeting, but if you need to leave because you have school, that would be fine. Your choice.
Thank you very much.
So if he has a comment he can make about the walls on the gun range, if you want to make
that wrong. What little weight do we only have two things on the regulation?
Yeah, that's right.
I think we need to make our comments. Okay, Ms. York, we have the Behavioral Health Center. Is Mr. Roos on video?
He is. Several commissioners have requested an update from Mr. Roos on the Behavioral Health Center, so he is going to provide that to you all as your next item.
And good evening, sir.
Hey, good evening. Can you hear me okay?
Absolutely.
Right.
We know who you are, and I know you're a very, very, very important person and my quickest and best contact with Maya. But if you would tell everybody, because it's on video and a whole courtroom full of people, your credentials.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, commissioners. Glad to be here tonight. My name is Donald Roos, and I am the Vice President of Behavioral Health and IDD network operations for VIA. So I manage our behavioral health provider network, our network development activities, as well as our provider trainings and communications in order to get our providers in our communities and hopefully our citizens access to the services that they need and deserve. And so glad to be here tonight. I first wanted to start off by thanking some of the commissioners and leadership of the county for personally calling me and some of our fellow co-workers after Hurricane Helene. They hit Western North Carolina and devastated a lot of our mountain communities. So I do appreciate all those who were concerned about me and reached out and sent sentiments as well as all those who were serving out here. So continuing those efforts out here, and so really appreciate all of the support. You'd be glad to know that RHA and the Divergent Center even played a role in it further east, where we had a facility that was non-operational and was able to stay at the Alamance Divergent Center temporarily until they could get access to other support. And so really appreciate the opportunities around that. My hope is tonight is to just give you a quick update on where we're at with the Divergent Center, what services are currently available there and which ones are phasing in as we go forward, and then offer any additional follow-up that we can provide. So just a quick rundown, and again, feel free to stop me. If you do have questions along the way, I wanna go over some of the services that are currently available there. Some of those may be new terms for any of you, so if you need me to stop and explain a little bit more of what they are and how they operate, just jump in and let me know. The first services around our adult services that we currently have there is we have what we call peer support services. And these are people that are employed that have lived experience, individuals that are recovering from mental health or substance abuse, addiction issues, are working there supporting other people. We actually have a unique program that's working out of that facility called a Peer Bridger Program. That Peer Bridger Program is designed to work for people that are coming out of the hospital, so Cone Health Hospital. If somebody goes on to their inpatient psychiatric unit, those peers will actually go to the hospital and help bridge people coming out of the hospital back to the community. As you know, or may not know, a lot of individuals coming out of psychiatric inpatient care are at the highest risk for committing suicide across our communities in North Carolina. So it's one of our most vulnerable populations. And so we really want to make sure as people get discharged from the hospital that they are getting connected to services coming out. And so we intentionally have a program that's going meeting people in the hospital and trying to bridge them and connect them to the supports as they're discharged in the services. We also have a program there called Community Support Team. It's a three-person team of people that work in the community, consists of a licensed professional, a qualified professional, as well as a paraprofessional that works on those teams that actually works in the community to engage people in community living skills and connecting them to all the services and supports they need. We also have a very high-end service called Assertive Community Treatment Team that's operating out of that building. You may be familiar with that, but that's our highest level of community-based treatment for mental health services in the community, and that consists of a psychiatrist, a nurse, a social worker, a housing specialist, an employment specialist that work as a team to make sure people are cared for in the community. The facility's also recently been licensed for a substance abuse intensive outpatient program, and so that services is there and available at the center, and that's one of our higher levels of care for substance abuse treatment in the center, and so that is operational and in the facility right now. We also have a supported employment team that's working out of the center, and so this is a team of people that's job is to do nothing but help connect people to employment opportunities. As you know, employment is a key component of recovery when people are recovering from mental health and substance abuse addiction. And so that team is actively working out of there, helping to connect people to employment services with that program. The facility also has a key program called a peer living room that was built into that. And that's basically like a drop-in center for individuals. If they need any support, they can drop in there. They don't need an appointment, anything else. They can just drop into that peer living room. The peer living room is supported with peer supports that are there to help support people, talk to them around any concerns they have. Maybe they're just feeling a little anxious that day. They don't need to see a therapist or anything, but they just want to be around other people. They can drop into that peer living room, get access to supports, be connected within the system. Really cool program. Encourage you guys to go out and check that particular program out. Our mobile crisis services also operate out of that center now. Our mobile crisis teams are basically a group of team that respond to emergency calls in the community. And so they're doing that all across Alamance County right now. They're also working a grant program right now in Alamance County called Co-Responder Model, which is a model directly working with your sheriff's department to where they're actually co-responding to calls coming from the sheriff's department and going out and connecting with them. We're hearing some great things about that program, and a few other counties have communicated with us that they're really excited about seeing something like that and expand in other counties. And so we can definitely provide some more information on that as we go on, but that mobile crisis and that co-responder continuing to build in the county. We also have full walk-in services in that facility, which means that people can walk into that service anytime during daytime hours, office hours, and get access to an assessment during that facility time. So that includes adults, children, mental health, substance abuse, and intellectual developmental disability can come in, get access to that assessment, which then triggers off the next services that they may need or need to access after that. They also have full outpatient services at the facility, which consists of individual therapy and group therapy in the facility. They have medication management services, psychiatric services available at the center, as well as from a psychiatrist or from a nurse practitioner at the facility. And then one of the newer programs that you guys are very interested in is the behavioral health urgent care that's operating at the facility. So the behavioral health urgent care right now is operating 7 days a week, 16 hours a day. And we have 8 beds operational in that behavioral health urgent care. Keep in mind, the urgent care is basically a 23-hour holding center. It's very operates just like any other urgent care on the physical health side. You know, you drop something on your foot, and your foot swells up. You go into the urgent care, and they figure out, did you break your foot? Is it just swollen? You need some ice on it. It's really how the urgent care operates. Is they you bring them in, they triage. They need to triage you over to a hospital, or they need to triage you to another service. They can do that, and they have a 23-hour period in order to do that. Right now, we're working on getting the additional 8 hours a day operational to get that urgent care to a 24/7 facility. RHA is working closely with the Sheriff's Department and the deputies within Alamance County and some of the municipalities to sign up sworn officers in order to be able to do that. We did try to go down the road of working with Cone around some of their officers, but we really ran into some barriers, especially with those security not being sworn officers and being able to do secured custody exchange for an involuntary commitment. So we continue down the road working with the county and those officers, and we're getting closer to closing in on getting that remaining 8 hours covered within the system. On the child side, we also have access to the assessments that I mentioned. The individual therapy is available for them, the medication management services. We also have a program for children called Intensive In-Home Services, which is a team of licensed clinicians that work with families in their homes that is available in the child side of the services in that particular part. The last component that we're, well, the last component, we also have the pharmacy available there, where individuals can one stop and get their meds at the pharmacy within the facility. The two pieces that we're working now to formalize and continue to build out is our facility-based crisis unit, which is the 16-bed facility that's at the facility. In order to get that operational, the state licensure codes require that the facility be staffed and staff trained prior to licensing the facility. And so we've been under the process of hiring qualified staff, getting those staff trained for those licensure review. I'm glad to report that that application is submitted and been with DHSR for over a month now on the Division of Health Services Regulation side, and we're waiting on them to schedule their site review so we can move forward, get that licensed, and get that unit open. We know that's a big part of the center, a big part of what the county needs. And at this point, we're just waiting on those. I've personally reached out to some contacts I have over there, requested that application to be expedited, and we're still waiting to hear back on whether we can get any movement to get that application move forward in the line. We know in other facilities, we've seen some turnaround in 60, 90 days, and I've had some facilities that have taken over a year to get DHSR to license, depending on the volume they have and their adequacy of their staffing. And so at this point, we're a bit at their mercy to get that particular piece done. The other piece we're working on is our community integration, and that's bringing in some of our partners to the facility. We have a couple there now. The ones we're working on, the national NAMI, National Alliance for Mentally Ill, to get them housed within there is one component, as well as our vocational rehabilitation partners, and then there's a few others. We're scheduled to have a meeting on November the 22nd, so later this week, to formalize the remaining calendar for those community partners and get those scheduled to window access and begin posting times and office hours within the facilities. So So I know I just went through a whole bunch of stuff really quick, but I'll pause and open it up for questions on any of that I just went through.
Ms. Thompson.
Hey, Donald, I'm so glad to see you because I know you're up in the Asheville area. How's it going?
It's going great. They just announced today that the water is drinkable in Asheville. So if y'all want to come down and go to some restaurants now, they are open and the water's drinkable as of today. So that's a huge milestone, and people have been waiting for that for a while. So happy to see that, and that will hopefully get some more of our capacity around some of our services up in as well. So thank you for asking.
That's good news. We've just watched horror on the news, and it's just been really heartbreaking. I was just curious. I had to take a 21-year-old client of mine over there. Well, I went first to the center and met with the business manager. I just went in. I didn't see a security person, but I went. They took me up to the upstairs, and I spoke with her. And she had told me then, it's been a couple of weeks ago, that the children's wing was not open. But is there some services activated in there, or is it like open, or just the few things that you were talking about, it is optional?
They should be operational over there now. So if you're not seeing it is, let me know. The last time we've had people over there, we were showing that it was operational.
Okay.
I did also want to offer to you, Pam, or any other commissioners, we have a standing meeting with all of those partners around some of the timing is every other Thursday. We're meeting and going over that. That's a meeting that's actually run by the county. Ashley Barber from the county facilitates that meeting, and it's a meeting with us and RHA and few other key partners where we go over this, the schedule and the timeline and what's working and what's not working. It's a constant push and pull, as you know, making sure that everyone's on the same page and working together to make things work successfully. And so we just open that up as well if any of the commissioners would like to join that meeting and get regular updates and ask questions at that meeting. Glad to have you.
Okay, I just have two other questions. Is the majority of the clients that are coming there, are they off the street, are they calling, or are they from the jail?
I don't have disposition data in front of me, Commissioner Thompson, but I can get that. I did pull just last month's data on how many people they served in the center. Last month in October, they served 723 unique individuals through that center, which is a pretty good number from what we see out there. I don't know how many of those actually walked in versus how many scheduled an appointment versus how many were brought over by law enforcement, but I can break that number down and get that to you.
Okay, and the last thing about security, what is the up-to-date security? Because when I was over there, there was a blue truck. I didn't see law enforcement, and I've seen that twice. I didn't know if that was the personal vehicle of the law enforcement, but I'm just curious about the law enforcement because you know that's it for me to making sure that we are safe with what can be possibly walking in there.
100% agree. I can't speak to the blue truck because I'm not sure what that is, but I can definitely ask about the blue truck. I know as of right now, RHA has under their contract security for 7 days a week, 16 hours a day. So that's basically two shifts a day through 7 days a week. And they're trying to recruit for that third shift position.
And who does that? Who has that contract?
Those are deputies and law enforcement that are signing off the calendar.
Okay.
Forget the term for that is, but they're basically posting the jobs for them to sign up with, and they're signing up on those through that portal. And we've been working closely with the sheriff to make those opportunities available for off-duty officers.
And that's paid by VIA?
Yeah, well, it's being paid by RHA right now through rates, yes. So there's no county contribution or anything to that at the moment.
Okay. Thank you. It's good to see you.
Yeah, good to see you as well.
Mr. Lashley.
Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Ross, the only thing I really wanted to elaborate on a little bit further, Ms. Thompson touched on it about security. You mentioned the sheriff department. The sheriff's department's always willing to take these things under his wing. He's doing a very good job of doing that. I want to elaborate a little further about, do you have any other municipalities reaching out to help man this security that you have?
You're referring to in Alamance County?
I'm referring to Burlington, Graham, Hall River, Elon, every municipality that we have. Have you had anybody from those municipalities reach out to help secure this location?
Previous, I'll need to check on that to confirm, Commissioner Lashley. Prior to a couple of months ago, when I was in the middle of some of that, we had not had any. I know that Sarah Huffman with RHA has been reaching out to some of those municipalities to see if she could get some of those officers engaged and part of the schedule. I cannot confirm or deny at the moment whether she's been successful in that, but I will follow up and get that information back to you and let you know if any have engaged at this point.
Thank you for that. And I really do appreciate that you will look into it, because everybody that's going to this facility is from Alamance County, and they also reside in the cities. If this partnership is going to work effectively, we have to make sure that we're all partners in this. The sheriff just can't take this on himself, because I know he's willing to do it. That's not the kind of man he is. But we need the help from the other municipalities to make this thing work in a more efficient and effective way.
I couldn't agree more. It's a full county effort. I know Sherry reached out to the municipalities a few months back, as well as I met with every municipality in the county and asked for their support in moving forward. And sad to say, I did not get any takers in my request at that time. And I know Sherry reached out and proposed a cost splitting plan with the municipalities to state that if you're not willing to commit deputies or support, would you be willing to commit any of your municipality funding to help cover the cost of that? Again, we didn't get any support around that either.
Sorry to hear that. Thank you, Chairman.
And Mr. Rouse, I would also be interested in hearing those statistics, the breakdown on how many are coming into the facility by law enforcement, specifically by which agencies they're bringing them in. I had an opportunity to meet with Chief Balog in Burlington about a week and a half ago, and he pointed out very specifically that he's checked, and their expense level for covering law enforcement officers having to stay in the facility under RHA, the old facility, for the past year was about $17,000 a year. So for them to take on a chunk of the cost in excess of that, from a financial perspective, he didn't feel made sense. And I think he felt like, I won't say he's speaking for the rest of the chiefs, but apparently the municipalities have a sense of it's the responsibility of the county, it's a county facility, and not the responsibility of municipalities, even though that's one of the reasons I'd like to see the details on this. Probably the majority of the problems that come into the facility are coming from municipalities and not from the rural parts of the county. And I want to make sure I'm right. I believe we funded, Susan or Heidi, wasn't it $450,000 for security in the budget? Something in that neighborhood. So there should be money in there for us to provide for it, but we just need to make sure we're getting what we need. Obviously, you can't use more people than you've got time for, but I really want to see this being able to run 24 hours a day and providing the service, because obviously, the numbers you just indicated, there's a need there.
Yeah, a couple things to remind. I will pull the data for you, but a couple things to keep in mind. One, you'll need to look at how much time those officers are not just spending at the old RHA facility, but how much time are they currently spending at the hospital? ED.
Right.
Because the goal is that they would no longer go to the hospital ED either. They would divert them into this facility, and so that time would also not be utilized. The other piece is when you see the data initially, the volume of officer drop-offs are going to be lower now than they will be in the future, because until the facility-based crisis is licensed by the Division of Health Human Service Regulation, it cannot be designated in law as an involuntary drop-off facility. And so law enforcement can drop off voluntary individuals now, but they can't drop off people on involuntary commitment until it's designated and licensed by the state. So once that happens, we'll be able to promote with law enforcement to drop off those involuntary commitments as well, and that will increase the numbers of law enforcement drop-offs significantly.
Thank you.
Yes.
Give me the number for October again, 700 and...
723 unique individuals.
That's amazing. And you do not have the involuntary yet. You're going to
pick
out more numbers. People in the audience and out in TV land or whatever it's called, video land, this center will it'll prevent the officers from sitting there for hours, either at the jail processing or the hospital processing. And I'm of the firm belief that the cities and municipalities have got to step up and help the sheriff's department out. It's just not right for one single agency to take the entire duty, because we're relieving them, the Burlington, Graham, Elon, so forth. Those officers are sitting hours and hours and hours at the hospital, for example. So it's going to free their officers up. They ought to share in that coverage. And Ms. Thompson, you pointed that out. I think all the commissioners agree. Mr. Carter and I have talked about meeting with Mr. Balog and the chief and Graham and so forth individually to encourage that. So we're trying to work that out. And we really appreciate everything that you guys have done. You did not slow down a single bit when you were flooded for weeks at a time with part of the time no power, until recently water that was drinkable and so forth. I have family that lives in that area, and I know personally the tough time you guys have had, and you didn't slow down a bit. Thank you.
One of the comment, Commissioner Chair, or question: would not this alleviate some of the problem? Would not the Behavioral Health Center alleviate some of the problem with the ER, with borders, people with psychological issues that are stuck in the emergency room? There are a couple of rooms over there with young people that have no place to go.
Yeah, 100%. Yes, our goal is to have those diverted over. The facility-based crisis unit is only for adults, but those young people, if they're in there and they're children, they can go through the behavioral health urgent care and be dispositioned and moved into other facilities. We have facilities all over our region that we can place individuals at. What happens is a lot of time if they go into the ED first, they get stuck in the ED because the ED does, their ED docs don't want to discharge to a lower level of care for some of those kids. If they go in through our urgent care, we're able to get them into other facilities like psychiatric residential treatment facilities in different parts of the state in a much timelier way. And so anytime we can divert them away from the ED and into our units, we can disposition them, get them back into the community a lot quicker as well.
But also indicate that there are actually two separate buildings. They have a causeway connection, but we do not segregate the children from the adults. Two separate buildings. It's just a wonderful opportunity for Alamance County, and we appreciate it. Sheriff Johnson, you had some comments.
Yes, sir. We,
if you will, step up to the mic, or you can step up to the mic here if you like.
Currently, we only have one officer being paid by RHA from the monies the county has given. I have met with all the departments earlier this year, wanting to know if they'd come on board. Burlington, in fact, they said no. Graham said no. Elon, Campus, Mebane, and Hall River and Gibsonville has interest in coming on board to help. But I can tell you this, right now, and probably the reason she didn't see no one over, we have one deputy, that's all that we have, that's being assigned there, and that's usually 8 to 5.
So your security isn't the entire time it's open?
Do what, ma'am?
So security,
no, ma'am.
It is, okay.
We're trying to get it that way, but the problem are we're short, and we're doing the best we can do at this time.
Mr. Rouse, I assume that the licensing will require security.
Technically, no. Licensure code does not require security in any of those facilities. The urgent care is a non-licensed facility, which is why it's open now. Facility-based crisis is a secure unit, and it's locked, and that's why it doesn't require security either via state regulation. So security is completely optional, technically. We have some units, some facilities across the state operate without security completely. I agree with Commissioner Thompson. It is best practice to have security there and available in order to do that. But other communities have other arrangements. For instance, in Buncombe County, they have what they call an on-call button on their facility to where they can hit that panic button and they can have security there within 5 minutes. And so that was one arrangement they made with the county where they didn't actually have to have an officer sitting there. And the county agreed that they would respond quickly. As you can imagine, their facility is probably, 2 miles down the road from the facility. And so they have cameras equipped in that facility as well. And so they can also monitor it remotely if they need to, and then have security on site in an emergency. And so that's kind of how they've been operating in that area. And so it's done different ways depending on the comfort level of the community and of the provider that's operating the facility.
Well, I think we'll have, I've talked to Mr. Carter, myself, and Ms. Thompson, and we all want to straighten that out, get secure help for the Sheriff's Department and for VIA. Two members going off, but Ed Friola will be sworn in on December 2nd. He's sitting here. I've talked to him about this issue. He's supportive. And he's shaking his head in affirmative action. And then a fifth county commissioner will be nominated and installed on December 2nd. So that who I think will probably be named is also supportive. So you have the county commissioners, again, Mr. Carter and I, along with Sheriff Johnson and county manager, plan to try to gain help with the different cities.
Donald, can I just make a comment? When I went over to the center, because I've been a fighter for this the whole time with what I've worked with, I went, parked, and went in, and didn't see an officer. This door was locked. It wasn't open. I went into the pharmacy, and I had on a badge. I'm commissioner, FBI, that badge. And I went in there, and I have watched some really nasty people do smash and grabs. I've watched them break in and steal thousands of dollars worth of pocketbooks and go to CVS and just rip off. And the first thing I thought of was that whole wall was drugs, nothing but drugs. And working with addiction, that's the ultimate thing right there. So I just really want to make sure, they were so nice sitting in there behind the counter, but I just really want to make sure they are the utmost safe, because that's the mother load for somebody to go in there, hurt somebody, and just take a bag and go for it. That's just the way I think, working with crime, I'm sorry. But I just that's a very hot spot with what all walks in the doors. Not everybody's in a great mood and stuff like that. And I just really, that's why I harp on security all the time. It's like the SRO at a school. It's that front line. And we had to go through security down here in this building when we come in tonight. In this day and time, in this world, we cannot shoulda, coulda, woulda. And I know you are working everything you can to get that. And I'm not going to stop running my mouth about it till I know it's there. So that with all the pharmacy, that just struck me as I thought, God, they're a sitting duck for the wrong person to walk in there. And it just really alarmed me, and that's why I'm saying something about it.
We support that 100%. We definitely agree it's best practice. But we also need to make sure we continue to get services out to people in the community.
Absolutely.
We just don't want to not operate these services waiting on some of the security, or else, individuals would not be able to access some of the services now. We do realize there's some risk involved with that. But at this point, we have not had an incident like that in any of our facilities. And so we think it's manageable at this time, but we would prefer to have security on there 24/7, 365. And we'll do anything to support the county, RHA, other organizations in order to make that happen.
Well, I know once we get settled and it starts running like it's supposed to, it'll be okay. But I'm just telling you how I feel, that's all.
No, 100% agree.
Let me say this, Ms. Thompson, you're absolutely correct. We're hoping that, we can have people sign up that will go there. Right now, if we had the manpower, I'd put them all there, because I know what my people would do. But at this point, we don't have that manpower where we can put eight people there, because when you have shifts and vacation and court and this other stuff, you're looking at least eight people to cover that facility 24/7.
May I make a comment, please?
Yes, sir.
Sheriff, as I wanted to make sure everybody's aware and praise you and praise what we've done so far in this board. You're picking up five more deputies. Are they all going to be deputies from BLET, or are some of them going into detention?
We had swore in seven today. Six was detention. One was outside deputy.
Is that from the BLET class, this new one?
No, we got a BLET class be graduating
it's
tomorrow night.
Coming out of that for the mm-hmm. sheriff's office, I believe, mm-hmm. right?
That's right.
Now, how will they disperse?
They'll be if they went through BLET, they're going to be dispersed with the openings we have on patrol at this time.
Okay. So hopefully we'll be seeing some of that, and that's part of that's a result of the efforts we've made as a board to try and provide bonuses for new deputies, signing bonuses. So.
Well, it's paying off. Like I say, we swore seven in today. We got more swearing in. But we can make this, if we can't get them full-time, we can get extra duty that they'll sign up for to cover that facility 24/7. And I can tell you this, the old sheriff's going to be there a couple of days, because I want to see what's going on there.
Okay. Thank you.
Excellent.
I want to make sure they're doing what they're supposed to do, and we're doing what we're supposed to do.
Mr. Lashley.
I'm good. Thank you.
And so am I. Donald, we really appreciate it. And Sheriff Johnson, thank you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, and hopefully next time I can join you in person. Have a good evening.
Thanks, sir. Okay. Are you introducing Ray Vipperman, or?
Well, I was Tommen.
Board, I'll introduce this next one for you. If you remember back in May, we adopted a new ambulance ordinance to allow for franchises of ambulances to come and assist and take over some of the convalescent transport duties that our folks normally perform in-house with the franchise folks. And we've gotten our first application as part of that process. It's been through the county review process, been approved by the county, and we've drafted a contract to comport with that, follows all the requirements of the franchise the ordinance you've already adopted. And this is the first franchisee here to speak with you this evening from Lifestar. This will be the first of two considerations for this. So our hope was to have a time for you to speak to the franchise operator tonight, get any questions you might have answered, and then it'll have to be read again and passed again at the next meeting. But I'll turn over the nuts and bolts to these guys at the podium.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. So we have Mike Coots, the director of LifeStar here, and his assistant director, Travis Dalton, there in the back. And they'll be able to answer any specific questions that you have about their facility. But like Rick said, through this franchise application process, we reviewed that. I had that reviewed by our medical director and our peer review, which consists of a lot of community partners. We did a facility tour of their facility and feel very confident in their abilities to assist us in this county. So a little background, of course, we do all of the emergency and non-emergency transports in Alamance County, all the point-to-point in the county, all the hospital discharges, doctor's office appointments, and then, of course, all the 911 calls. And a lot of times those things start to compete and really put strain on our resources. So, of course, through that franchise ordinance, we just felt it was the time and working with county management to bring someone else in to focus on those non-emergency transports from the hospitals and those doctor's office facilities so that we can do what we do best and respond to the 911 calls. Because if you don't, I think I mentioned this in July, but if you don't get folks out of the hospital, then they wind up getting backed up. So when you're bringing folks into the hospital, they can't take as good a care. So if you've got one agency focusing on getting the hospital cleared out while we're bringing patients in, everybody just gets served better. So I'm happy to answer any questions that you have for me. And then if you have LifeStar specific questions, they'll be happy to address those.
I reviewed the contract. I was impressed by the number of units that you have available. The fact that you're from Winston-Salem, graduated from Wake Forest University School of Law, so I'm a little bit familiar with that.
Okay.
And Forsyth County is a good county. Tell us about yourself.
Okay, so we are based right there in Winston-Salem. We started up in 2009, so just celebrated 15 years. We serve five counties right now. The majority of our load is right there in Forsyth County. So this will be an excellent opportunity to move in this direction, and we're really looking forward to this.
Mr. Turner, questions?
I'm good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Thompson.
Will you drive from Forsyth, or will you have ambulances on, like, here located?
No, ma'am. We're expecting to be able to find a place to lease initially as a base here. And so our employees will report here, and our vehicles will be stationed here.
Okay. I think it's a great idea. I really appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Mr. Lashley.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you for being here tonight. I'm really glad to hear from you. And I do think this is definitely needed in our county. Most of the places that I lived in the Northeast and the Midwest had partnership with public and private. And it worked out pretty good. The questions that I'm receiving are more of the, would, and Ms. Bifferman, you may have to step in here. Will this company be, will they do any of the emergency things? If your guys are too busy or what, can they do the emergency side of it as well?
So we don't plan to do that initially, with the exception of if there was a situation where we were completely out of ambulances and they were in service within the county, we might would ask them to respond to a call, but they would not be in our rotation.
So their initial is going to be non-emergency transportation?
Yes, sir. Yes.
And you said your company's been in business for how long, sir?
15 years.
15 years. Do you currently do any other counties around here?
Yes, we are. We're in five other counties, Surrey, Stokes, Forsyth, Davidson, and do some work in Guilford.
Okay. Thank you for your time. Thank you, Chairman.
And I might indicate that in the agenda, everything's posted online. Everything, including their contract, is available for your review. There's a lot of detail there, including you're charging the same cost as our ambulance service, so there's no additional cost to county residents. Doesn't matter whether you're in city, out of city, whatever, these folks will thank goodness be available. And the county attorney, upon our approval, will be able to sign their franchise contract, and you'll be ready and available. Okay. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Any other questions from county commissioners?
Oh, I haven't had a comment yet.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Carter.
I really don't have a problem at all. I mean, I'm very tickled to see that we have an opportunity here to engage a company with a record like yours to help us meet the needs of our citizens. That's our primary function, is to make sure our citizens are taken care of. And I want to point out, too, for the audience, we have interagency agreements with surrounding counties to back us up, and we back them up. I mean, it was the comment was made in the media recently that counties backed us up. It kind of further down in the article, it alluded to the fact that we might back them up, but it goes both ways. And, we're backing them, and they back us. But we want to try and grow. I think one of the things we're looking at right now in our list of functions for next year, items of need, is another EMS station and more EMS workers. So we're trying to grow all this to meet the need. We're an extremely rapidly growing county, one of the fastest growing counties in the state. And that means we face a lot of problems, which you don't see every day. If you live in the rural parts of the county, you don't see all this. It's going to come about more and more as we see the growth down in northeast Randolph County impacting southwest Alamance County and other parts of our communities. But these needs are growing. The needs for sheriff's office having staffing is growing. EMS needs are growing. Our hospital is growing. You name it, we're growing everywhere. We're busting at the seams. So thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity we have with you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Board, the agenda item is not entirely clear, and that's my fault, but I do need a vote tonight as to whether to approve the franchise. We'll have to vote the same issue again at the next meeting, but I need a vote tonight on the franchise agreement.
All right. You need a vote tonight and then a reread at our next meeting, which is what? The 16th, I believe.
December 2nd.
December 2nd.
Yes.
Yeah.
Motion to approve.
I'll second.
A motion to approve and second. Any further comment? There being none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you, boy.
Thank you.
Says, guys, as I was corrected, we'll have another reading in approximately 2 weeks. And again, we remind everybody, this whole packet, I don't know how many pages, probably 25, 30 pages, is about this franchise agreement. So I would really encourage everybody, in particular the Almost Eagle Scout, to look at materials and study them before meetings. And once you're an Eagle Scout, you realize that you're then obligated to provide public service in your future. Thank you. When I was in scouting, you leave it better than you found it. Is that correct?
That's right.
Thank you. Okay. County manager's report.
I don't have anything to report tonight, Board. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we do one thing before county commissioners? I want to substitute number 8 and 9.
Move number 9 to 8 and 8 to 9.
Is this where the beating begins?
I'll make a motion to that effect.
I'll second it. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Mr. Turner.
Mr. Chairman.
Would you please stand?
Here it comes.
We we have two commissioners that are going off effectively normally December 2nd, which would be our next meeting. And that also is our organizational meeting. Mr. Turner had the audacity to run for a judgeship and was elected, thank goodness. He'll serve the county well. In recognition of your service, the plaque reads, in recognition of outstanding service, and I agree with that, and leadership presented to William Craig Turner, Jr. Do you know that person? He was sworn in on February 1st, 2021, and is serving through Wednesday when he effectively will be stepping down. Unfortunately, he will miss our December 2nd meeting because he will be going to a required judgeship meeting on the time of our meeting on December 2nd. So we're gonna miss you. Not all of your comments. Sincerely, we truly appreciate and honored to serve with you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Congratulations.
I think he deserves a round of applause.
Mr. Jordan, thank you, sir. Okay. Now, county commissioners' comments. Mr. Turner, we'll give you the first comment.
Okay. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the wonderful plaque and for the kind words. This is my last meeting. Just some parting comments. It may take a little longer than in the past, but just three things. I just wanted to explain the timing for the resignation, some word of thanks, and then a parting thought. I had the honor to be elected district court judge in the last election. I start judge school on December 2nd. That's a week long. It's mandatory. I can't be here at the organizational meeting on December 2nd and at the at that. So you either have a meeting with four commissioners or resign in time for my position to be filled for that meeting. And I thought it's the best idea to have the full commission take their seats all together. And that means resignation now to allow the Republican Executive Committee to name the replacement in time. So that's an explanation of the timing. A word of thanks. First of all, I want to thank staff. You guys are wonderful and have done truly remarkable work over the last 4 years. We've, I think, as a board, done a lot for recruiting and retaining people. You're an example of, I mean, being able to retain you guys is a true testament, I think, to your commitment to this county and to our efforts to make sure we keep quality people. So the folks here in the room representing over 1,000 Alamance County employees, thank all those folks for their work, and we hope you stay in Alamance County and keep doing the great work that you've done. Particularly Heidi, thank you for your leadership. We've been really, really impressed. I have, and I know the board has, with your efforts over the past couple of years, and hope you stay a long, long, long time. So thank you to staff. Thank you to my family. Got married.
I see some of them here, by the way.
Just got married a year ago, and you know, public service is not for the faint of heart. So thank you to my bride, Julie. And the blended family that we've created, and my parents and friends who have been helpful and supportive along the way. So thank you to y'all. To the members of this board, we've been together for 4 years, all five Republicans, and we've had some unanimous decisions, but some not unanimous decisions on some very, very important decisions. I think that's an indication of the diversity of thought on this board, different backgrounds, different passions. And I thank all of you for, I couldn't, now, it may be, I will admit that at least once over the last 4 years, I've been annoyed at least one of you. I'm not going to mention any names, but I could not have imagined serving with a better group of people
I cherish your friendship. I honor your service. And I thank you for the opportunity to have served this 4 years with you. And to the citizens of the county, I thank the Republican Party for taking a chance on me 4 years ago. And the citizens who affirmed that with a vote to keep me in this seat. I have tried my best to make the right decision. I have studied the issues. I have tried to approach it from all angles. May not have made a popular vote all the time, but I made the vote that I thought was right. I may not have always been in the majority, but I tried to do what was right for the citizens, and that's true. I thank you for sending me to the court, and I'll do my best there to continue to serve the citizens of the county. And a parting thought. The most difficult and challenging time over the last 4 years, it's probably no surprise it was, you know, the disagreements and the almost feuding that developed with the school system, between this board and the school system. We've gotten a lot better in the past few months. I think we're at a tipping point. We've got a new board on both sides. We've got new leadership with ABSS. I think that it is inevitable that there is conflict between our boards. We have different roles. We do different things. But we are at our best as a board when we have relationships with other elected leaders in the county. That has to be a two-way street. There has to be respect on each side and everybody reaching out and trying to develop those relationships. I also think we're at our best when we are working together to establish long-term plans and to execute long-term plans. And I think we tried to do that initially with our top 10 list. I think we had a varying degrees of success over time on trying to prioritize the facilities planning for the schools. But I think when I'm thinking about looking forward and what could we do to have a long-term plan and to continue to develop relationships, to have transparency in our planning, to prevent surprises in our planning, particularly with respect to facilities. I think it's a good idea, and I'm just going to throw it out, and I don't anticipate any comment tonight, but just maybe some thinking about it. I think this idea of an ad hoc committee, a joint committee, a couple of commissioners, a couple of ABSS board members, it lasts a year. It has one function. Its function is to work together to determine what the status of the schools are. Maybe staff's on it, maybe a couple of appointees from each board. There's transparency. It comes together. It analyzes at a high level what the status is. We can all agree on what the facts are. We see what the schools, what kind of shape they're in, and then working together to prioritize what needs to be done first. I think that accomplishes those two things. It works together to establish a long-term goal, and it can help to make those relationships a little bit better so that we're working towards that goal. Not everybody has to agree. I don't think everybody's going to agree. I still think there'll be conflict. But it can be conflict in a way that is productive. And I think that this idea is a way to do one thing together to keep the county moving forward. That's my idea. That's my take. Thank you again, everyone. And we'll see you in the courtroom.
No.
Hopefully not.
Well, I will make one comment. I have popped in on a judge just to watch a proceeding one time, and he halted the proceeding for it. So if I happen to do that, don't do that.
Well, let's go.
Sometimes you don't want everybody else in there to know who you're a commissioner.
Let's go. Steve is a defendant.
No.
Ms. Thompson.
I've just got some questions, and I need to ask them. Because I'd sent them to Heidi, and I got one of them resolved tonight with Vaya, because I've been real concerned about the stories. You always hear the negative. That's just the way it is with gossip. But I'm so glad Donald, my friend, I'm glad he's here, and he's okay, and I hope Asheville's going to be okay. I know last year's cost to the county for the Alka Vets Balloon Festival was a little over $30,000. And this year's cost to the county, that's the county, the taxpayers, if we include the fee that we waived that I didn't vote for and Craig didn't either for the facilities with $4,000, it's $29,459.33. this board has been real adamant, not me, but many of you have, and that's your right. We all are different, like Craig said, about not doing some things for nonprofits. We didn't help the Friendship Adult Day Center over at our building that was donated to the county, millions of dollars. And I have real concerns about us doing things like this for one particular. I am the daughter of a Korean War veteran, Air Force, and I'm the mother, very proud, ridiculous mother of a United States Army veteran. He was a sergeant when he came out. So nobody supports the soldiers and the Marines and the airmen and all of that like I do, and I will stand the line for them. But I do have concerns about us doing stuff like this because we are providing nearly $30,000 for a nonprofit to have a festival, and that's not, and their profit is, I don't know what their profit is. We don't know what their profit is. I wouldn't mind knowing what it is if I'm privileged to know that. And also, I have a question for the sheriff, because I know you are short. It's chronic. And we have put in $300,000 with the bonuses to help with hiring and stuff. I need to ask you, when you say about the RHA and over there at that, I see sheriff's deputies at the theater. They're at my church. They're at Harbor Inn. They're all kind of places. Is that on patrol, or is that hired personally? How does that work? Because I don't know. That's why I'm simply asking.
That goes through Extra Duty Solutions,
who
pays the officer through, you know, the company that's
like Harvest Baptist,
security through Extra Duty Solutions to the officer.
Okay, so that's not through you. That's not to you.
No, ma'am.
Okay, that's them privately. They wear their sheriff's uniform.
Extra Duty Solution, takes the taxes out on them, gives them the W-2 forms and stuff like that.
Okay.
They do wear the sheriff's uniform, and there's one thing that I believe in. A lot of people, wonder why we do extra duty. Let me tell you something. If you're a burglar or you somebody wanting to shoot up a church or something, and you see that patrol car there, you're not going to do that at that church or that business.
Well, we've all seen this happen across this country.
Yes, ma'am.
I just ask because I don't know.
No, I understand.
Okay. And I'd like to know, is the sheriff's department ever going to get body cameras?
It was in our last budget, but it got cut out.
Well, that needs to not...
We're looking for grants right now to try to do that.
Well, if we can find you $300,000 in bonuses, we can find you money for body cameras. Because that protects you.
$1 million.
Well, I'm not going to say nothing, but I think that's that important. Because other places have it, and you don't.
I understand.
And that protects you and your officer.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Sure does.
And I wanted to say about the ambulances. I met with Ray Vifferman Friday, I believe it was, to talk about this because I saw we were on the news. And anytime we have a something, it's always our fault. And I remember when the school bus was an accident and there were multiple children and it took several ambulances to come. I know that whenever it happens, I was on Interstate 40 when the big pileup happened. I was leaving the Mebane Citizens Police Academy, and we were stuck on the highway for I don't know how long. I never knew there were so many wreckers that I'd never heard of in my life come up the road, ambulances too. And the thing about it is, stuff like that doesn't happen all the time, but when it does, we have to cover for each other. And Ray was real quick to tell me that we cover for Orange, we cover for Guilford, mm-hmm. We cover that. And we were talking about the fire part thing, that BMS thing that had considered for Mebane and the expense in that. Mebane is just so massive, and they're growing like crazy, and they're doing a great job at it. But the southern part of our county is going to blow up too because of Toyota and all this other stuff. I'm telling y'all, that is going to be such a change to that community. And Eli Whitney is awesome. So is Snow Camp, Sylvan, all that. But they're going to need something like that right at hand. And we need to think about that. I'm a person of vision. I'm always looking in the future. And I want us to think about that because nobody can wait. And it's you talk about 5 minutes from a place if something happens at the diversion center. There's a lot of people that can be killed in 5 minutes. That's like a school till you get there. I've always lost it over Pleasant Grove and AO and Sylvan because the transport time, you could do so much damage to our children. So that's why we got SROs. And I don't want you to go. Mm.
I've talked about how many times I've saw Top Gun because of you, and just you've been such an ally with me when we have fought so hard for the schools, and I'm gonna really, really miss you because it's just different. I appreciate your friendship. I won't be in court, no. not yet. But I just want to thank you because I remember one time, Julie, you weren't here. I looked over and I saw that ring on that finger, and I went, "Oh my God, he's married!" And I was just so happy for you two. You're both so precious. But I just want to stay for a second. Last week I had to have a procedure. And they had to put me to sleep. And it's the worst kind of procedure you can have. And y'all, it starts with a C. Coscopy. And anyway, oh my God, I would have given my kidney for somebody to just give their results for me. It was awful. But I had a person called Casey Goldwyn. And she's one of our rock stars, EMTs that works for the county. And she was my person. She missed this vein, but she got this vein. And I'm gonna tell you, she kept me so preoccupied with her amazing customer service and her manner of her profession that I didn't even dread it. And I told him, I said, "This better not be on a TikTok." That's all I'm gonna say. But she was absolutely amazing. And it's people like her that I was talking to because, you know, when you have that procedure, you don't get to eat. And it's just awful. And I was so hungry. And just hungry. And I thought about our schools, the roles they play for kids. They got breakfast and lunch. And I've never been hungry in my life because I was poor and I didn't have anything. And I know there are kids that are. I'm sorry. And I just want us to always do right by our children in our schools because they don't have what many of us have. We don't know what they walk out of. And what they walk into, it's like recreation and parks. I'm always going to fight for our children and ones who teach them in our military because they all matter. Our farmers, everybody matters. And that's why this next year, starting out, this commission is going to have vision. And we're going to have to look at all the departments and make sure all the departments are healthy and have what they need. And it's been an honor to serve with you because I respect you as an Army mom, and you got a Navy mom out there, and I know she loves you, and so does your wife. That's a cut above of a person, and I thank you for your service, and it's just been a joy to serve with you. And I know you're the one, I'm the one you're talking about that annoys you. And I really don't care. But you've been like a brother, and I really appreciate you.
Thank you, Ben.
Mr. Lashley.
Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I want to thank the speakers tonight for bringing this issue to our attention. You're going to have to probably end up going to the planning department and saying it all again, because they are the folks that can probably help your situation much quicker. I think you heard from one of the speakers tonight, Mr. Vines, about countywide zone. That's something that a lot of folks in this county don't want to talk about. We're the only state in the county, in the state. We're the only county in the state that doesn't have countywide zoning. And I do believe that we would have less issues. Like, look at the Snow Camp Mine, for example. Issues like that. Now, is it going to solve all your problems? No. But at least a county citizens need to start thinking about these things and how it's going to impact them, because look how it's impacted you. So I'm just thankful that you came out tonight and told us exactly how you felt and what the solutions you think are at hand. Thank you, because this is the only thing you have to do is recourse to your government, is to tell them what happened.
Thank you for acknowledging.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Just want to talk about some other things that you've heard this evening. About the Alco vets. I don't need to take the time to tell Ms. Thompson that we don't have, we actually fund other nonprofits. It's just we didn't fund the nonprofits that you like.
That's really rude, Bill. Because that's not true.
Well, it's a fact. Friendship Adult Daycare had some serious issues about funding, giving citizens money to Friendship Adult Daycare. There were some issues. Everybody knows what they were.
Yep.
So that's the reason why they didn't get the funding. But we do fund nonprofit organizations. And if you don't believe me, you can sit down with the county manager and you can look in the budget and she will show them to you.
I worked for two of them, so I know you're correct.
Okay, just want to make that clear because I just didn't understand why you would throw Alcovets under the bus. They're actually trying to do a lot of good help. I'd like to mention what the sheriff was saying, extra duty solutions. I've talked to a lot of your deputies, and they use that extra duty solutions to actually help their families extra income. And I do believe that you guys do a good job at the sheriff's department. We can and should budget for your duty, your deputies to have cameras. I think it would help them, and something you guys do a lot of tough stuff, but it would help them in situations where we had, for example, the lady who got hit at 2 a.m. would help situations like that quite a bit to clear things up and not have so much ambiguity and give people a reason to sort of take advantage. With all that being said, this is my last official meeting. I will be here December 2nd to go through the process to hand the baton over to a new board. But I just want to thank the board that I'm currently serving with for everything. I specifically thank Craig for his speech that sounded really good. You seem like you hit everything. You hit the nail on the head on everything. And I just want to, the only thing I had a couple of goals when I started this position last December, is to be a watchdog for the taxpayers of Alamance County and sort of keeping a close eye on the finances. Like Craig Turner said, we did a lot of big things on this board's term, the last 4 years. Not only did we see our county manager retire, but we had to hire a new one, and I think we did a damn good job on this one. And we also had to relieve our county attorney and hire a new one. And I think we did a great job on that one as well. I just want to thank the staff for all their work, especially Tori, keeping me out of trouble. I really do appreciate all your hard work, and I hope the citizens of Alamance County see how hard you guys work and what a great job you do, because you're very conscientious about your work product. And Susan, I know you're going to be happy not to have to hear my phone calls any longer.
I will miss you.
But we had a really good time, and we really tried to do the best job we possibly could. And the only second goal I had was I just wanted to be able to add some value to my team, and I hope to this board I've done that for you. So thanks to everyone. Thank you, Chairman. And I'm done.
Mr. Carter.
Well, we've had a lot come up tonight, and kind of being almost on the butt end. John's on the butt end, but kind of being on the butt end of it. I've asked our county attorney, Rick Stevens, to be prepared to address some of your issues tonight from the perspective of what we can do. One of the things we can do is look at an ordinance regulating gun ranges, requiring them to be approved at the planning department. Now, the problem with that is that's not going to affect any existing gun ranges. Another problem we have, and I agree with what Commissioner Lashley has said, an option we really are seriously going to need to take a look at is zoning, because we are going to, if you think we've grown rapidly in the last 20 years, you ain't seen nothing yet.
mean, the projections are right now we'll add another 30,000 citizens, another almost 50,000 by 2050. 30,000 by 2035, I believe it was. I could be a little off on that, but anyway, that's whatever the actual number is from this point, that's a lot of people. And they've got to have a place to live, and you're not always going to like where they want to live. You're not always going to like the impact on your particular spot in the county. But it's something I'm afraid we're going to have to take a look at. From the perspective of law enforcement and the extra duty solutions, just about every agency in the county allows their officers to perform that service to jewelry stores, other businesses, whatever might have a need, whether it's a doctor's office, a drug store, or whatever if somebody wants to hire law enforcement for safety, they can arrange that through our sheriff's department or through other agencies. Cameras, I agree. We need to have that in the budget next year. Folks, there's so many things that if you look at what we do in the budget process, I mean, I know nobody likes the idea of seeing taxes go up. That's not what we start out trying to do with a budget. If anything, we start out trying to keep the taxes down. I think that's a goal of everybody on this board, and I think I know some of the potential and new members coming on the board. I know Ed for a fact that's a goal that he has. The things we need, you can't always add, and you can't always say, okay, there's $1 million for cameras. Where are we going to take $1 million out of something else? We take a look at a zero-based budget every year. We look at every need in every department and make a determination about whether that department needs that particular line item in their budget going forward. So we look at that just like a business every year. You can't add the people you need. You can't retain the people you need in an inflationary environment without seeing some increases in expense. I mean, we live in the same place you do. If everything's going up that you buy at the grocery store or anywhere else, gasoline prices are going up. Hopefully, with this election, we're going to see some stuff start to come back down. I hope it'll have the impact I'd like to see between now and our budget cycle. But it's difficult to try and do that. And that's one of our primary jobs, try and come up with a budget that meets the needs of our citizens and doesn't cost you more than it has to. And I would be remiss if I didn't point out, we are the 18th lowest tax rate in the state. 100 counties, we have the 18th lowest county tax rate. That's something you should think about. I told this guy when he ran, I was going to hate it like the Dickens if he won, but I wanted him to win because I think he'll make a damn good judge. And I know the citizens are going to benefit by having him on the bench, not in it, of course, I hope, but on it. I don't want to ever see you get to the point where you're in the bench. But thank you for your service. You've been a lot of fun to work with. You've been a real asset. And I feel the same way everybody else does. I feel like you're a brother. And I'm going to really miss you. That's all I have to say tonight. Oh, one other thing. I did ask Rick to be prepared to say something during attorney's comments about the issue your folks are dealing with. So,
yes, and I will.
I don't appreciate the negative comments about the nonprofits. We do provide for a number of nonprofits. They typically are providing child care services, they're providing counseling for individuals and things of that sort. AlcoVets is one of the absolute stars of nonprofits. They're not the not the Veterans Service. That's a whole different county office. Alco Vets is not a county office, but they provide such a tremendous service to our veterans in Alamance County. And the Bloom Fest, it was alluded to the fact that we're giving away $4,000. The agreement that the county commissioners agreed to was they have done thousands of dollars worth of improvements for Cedar Rock Park, and we offset that $4,000 in monies that we don't require them to pay for the services, the gravel, the piping, the electric services, all kinds of things that they provide. They go on the whole. If they could just pay $4,000 and the county provide all that, we, the county taxpayers, would lose on that proposition. So I just want to say thank you publicly to Alco Vets for everything they've done for improving Cedar Rock Park and for the service to our veterans and what they have done. Mr. Turner, your suggestion with the Oversight Committee, we already have that. We curtailed some of those meetings during COVID, but we have started those back. That's a meeting with two board members with ACC, two ABSS board members, two county commissioners, and we meet once a month along with Ms. York and Ms. Evans, Mr. Stevens, and a number of other county officials, and ACC officials, and ABSS officials. So that's ongoing. Plus, we are starting in December, again, a monthly meeting with the chair, with the county manager, with the superintendent of schools, and with the chair of the school board. So all that's resuming. And I thank you for your suggestion, but thank goodness we're already doing it. So Craig was not on the Oversight Committee, which is why he probably doesn't know about all that. But Steve Carter and I we are every month and meet with them monthly. Good suggestion. Thank goodness we're doing it. Now, the situation, as Mr. Turner has already pointed out, has improved dramatically with ABSS, the school system. Much, much, much better now that they've had a change in superintendents and some of their personnel. They are not having, hopefully in the future, the financial loss of millions of dollars that they have had in the past. Thomas, I see you sitting there. You've reported it all, and accurately. So we know what the problems are. With the new administration with the school board, I feel like that has changed for the positive tremendously. Now, we're going to pick on Mr. Lashley December 2nd. So he's already given his speech. We're going to require him to give it again.
No, that's the last one you get.
And Mr. Turner, I agree with everything that was said. Been a real pleasure.
Thank you,
Mr. Thank you. That's all I have.
I'd just like to tag on to something. No, I'm certainly not throwing Alco Vets under the bus. I just have a right to ask questions. I remember you asked questions of one, you've asked questions, we've all asked questions. And if we get to the point where I can't ask the sheriff to give me, to help me understand about when I see a car parked at the theater, I think I have a right to ask him that, because I think he would want me to know that. Because I always want the truth, the truth. And so I love sighs and snippets. I just love it. But I just, nobody's throwing them under the bus. I've donated them. I appreciate what they do. But while you're smiling, I just want you to know that I do have a right to ask questions when it's tax money. And that shouldn't offend you, because we all do that.
It doesn't.
I wasn't talking to you anyway.
It does not offend me.
Okay, I just want to make sure it doesn't. I was talking to John, and if you want to have one last before we leave, we'll be fine.
Okay, county attorney.
You're not in this meeting. Trust me.
So a couple of things. I have a closed session. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead, huh?
I have a closed session motion for later, but I know a lot of folks behind me have questions about shooting and ranges, and the board had asked for me to have a back and forth and an update with you all on that. I think it's most appropriate if I answer your questions and give you that information in open session. So I want to take just a second to go ahead and give you some information about the lay of the land as it stands in Alamance County as to shooting ranges, and then I can entertain any questions you might have. I don't want to speak too specifically about some of the concerns that have come up tonight, just because I'm not fully...
Can everybody hear what he's saying?
Yes, sir.
Everybody can? Okay.
Okay, good. I'm not totally up to speed on the nuances of the situations that have been brought up, so I don't want to speak to those necessarily, but I want to remind the board a couple of things. So there's a state law, 14-409.46, that deals with shooting range protection. That is a state law that says that whatever noise ordinance is in place when a range begins operation is the law that applies to that range throughout the course of its operation as it relates to noise and noise pollution. So if a range opened, let's say in 2021, at that point, our county ordinance at that time, the most recent adoption of it was in 2019. Our board adopted a new noise ordinance in 2022 that would be in place as to any range that opens now. And that state law deals mostly with noise and noise pollution, not anything else. So nothing related to reckless fire, endangerment, nothing like that, just noise. There is, however, not a state law that deals specifically with the shooting of rounds onto a person's property unless it goes into a building or a vehicle. So it's not to say that you can't make an argument about damage to property for having damaged someone's trees, their real property, but there's not a specific violation that says you fired a round onto my property from your property. If the board recalls, last year we entertained a conversation about making that a violation of law under county ordinance. That effort was read a few times, revised several times, and didn't pass. But Commissioner Carter is correct. Several counties do have a shooting range ordinance that outlines setbacks, noise, things like that. If the county were to want to entertain an ordinance like that, that could be an option as relates to enforcement as to ranges that would open after the date that we adopt that ordinance. It wouldn't apply necessarily to any ranges that were in effect at the time the ordinance would be adopted. So that's pretty much the lay of the land. Oh, I also want to make sure that the board knows there's not, that I can find, any federal or state guideline that deals specifically with the way that a range has to be set up, that requires inspections, requires certain safety standards. I think there's some confusion because the state actually operates several shooting ranges that the state owns and maintains and operates through its wildlife division. There are laws on the books that apply to those ranges and require certain things, but that doesn't mean that those laws apply to other private or other commercial ranges in the state. So I hope that gives you kind of an overview of where we are. I'm happy to entertain dealing with or looking at specific concerns moving forward, but that's where we are right now, and I'll take any questions from the board.
We had one of our attendees present us with some information on North Carolina shooting range regulations.
Yes.
You have a copy of that, I believe?
Yes.
I would assume that it's under the enforcement provision of the Sheriff's Department to enforce that, and we've checked these provisions out.
Yes. So I don't want to disparage anyone who brought materials for us to review, but I'm trying to find the page. I looked at that earlier because I was curious. This is the last page. It looks like a Google search.
It was under tab 7, last page on tab 7.
Yeah, tab 7, page 2. If you look at the top, it says AI overview. This is what returned from, it looks like a Google search, and it says in North Carolina, shooting range regulations include. It is entirely possible that there are local governments in North Carolina that have those regulations in place. There is not, that I know of, a state law that requires those things. Unfortunately, this is not what happens when you trust Google results. That is not a state law. There may be local governments that have adopted those standards. It could be something that we decide to adopt. but I'm not sure that anything here cites specifically a statute that I was able to find. And I did look at that while we were having the meeting.
Speaking of Google and accuracy, according to Google, we make about $163,000 a year for being commissioners. I can testify that if that's a fact, somebody's been shortchanging my paycheck.
Yes. Do I talk to Susan about the balance?
I'll say that is not a fact. Google it.
And again, I'm not trying to disparage anyone. I'm just saying that I've checked this. I can't find any statewide applicable standards that look like these. Again, I think some of the confusion comes from the fact that the state actually owns and operates ranges, and it has a state law that applies to those ranges, but that's not what we're talking about in Alamance County. One of those facilities does not exist here.
May I say something? Mm-hmm. Those rules are for safety.
Right. Yeah, we know.
That's what we're looking for. We're looking for safety.
Okay, Mr.
I certainly think we probably need to look at resources and other examples of best practices if we decide to adopt a shooting range ordinance. But again, some of that's going to require us to look at land use as part of that process.
Well, and to be perfectly honest, 200 feet from any other property line, I think, is kind of tight or kind of maybe not enough. But maybe we can look at incorporating, if we look at a provision such as this, we can look at incorporating something similar to this in our...
Yeah, if you recall, we talked about shooting ordinances, and some counties have those. I believe both of the counties to our west and our east have a shooting ordinance that requires the person who shoots to be a certain number of feet from an occupied or other dwelling unless they have the permission of the person who owns or is occupying the dwelling to shoot. We don't have that in Alamance County.
Well, I have talked personally to planning board members and asked them to at least address this issue. Mr. Vines, you were one of the ones that I talked to. So planning board hopefully will look at this and make recommendations in the future.
We can certainly do that if the board would like. I'm happy to draft and redraft, and we can consider ordinances if that's what you would like to do. I'm happy to answer any more questions that you might have as well.
Can the audience ask the question?
No, sir. I'm sorry. You can during our break. Sure. Yes, sir.
Saw last Wednesday.
All right, you have a further.
Do what?
Business transaction.
Shot up, berms on splitting the property. There's been a survey.
They're moving the property lines.
They're moving the property lines and stuff like that themselves, where they've had, the property marked off, who's on one side. They moved the property line. There was a fire fire rain about 2 acres, burned down there. And it's really, really a mess. And I can tell you, Rudy, ain't gonna listen to a doggone thing.
You can make an ordinance, it won't matter.
Well, I don't want to address specifics related to circumstances or businesses, but I will just say that I'm not saying, and I've never said, that shooting ranges are exempt from the law and above the law. There are certainly things that could be criminal. They could be civil causes of action that might exist as to some of the businesses that have been discussed, but they're not necessarily things that apply to the county's ordinance-making ability. That's kind of what we're here to talk about now. Noise is the most common complaint that I've heard, and I wanted to make sure that we address that.
You can hear safety.
Bullets leaving the gun range is what we're concerned with.
Safety.
That can kill you.
All right, we have a meeting that we need to conclude, and we have other business. And I apologize, but we give speakers the opportunity at the beginning of the meeting. I and the other commissioners will likely be glad to talk to you after the meeting, but I can't let just everybody disturb the meeting. Mr. Stevens.
Any more questions from the board on that topic? Okay, if not, then pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143.318.11(a)(6), I would ask the board move into closed session to consider the qualifications, competence, performance, character, fitness, conditions of appointment, or conditions of initial employment of an individual public officer or employee, prospective public officer or employee. And I don't expect to have anything to report out when we finish.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make the motion that we move into closed session.
Second.
Pursuant to Mr. Stevens' criteria and that we be allowed to consult with the county attorney concerning to protect attorney-client privilege with respect to noise ordinances in the county.
Second.
We have 2 seconds.
I'm sorry.
With respect, Mr. Turner, I don't know, and perhaps we can have a conversation about this elsewhere, but I'm not sure that there's a way for us to have a closed session to consider a policy matter that doesn't relate to ongoing litigation. And I appreciate your desire to have that conversation in that way. I'm happy to entertain those questions here.
Well, I think the questions that we may ask may not be about policy, but may be about specific instances of that could lead to litigation.
If the questions are aimed at the county's liability in that instance, then that may be appropriate, yes. Thank
you. That's my motion.
All right. I'll modify amend my second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye. Aye. Any opposed? We're in closed session. Thank you.
Okay, we're back in order.
It's okay.
We had a closed session. No actions were taken. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved. Second.
Do I have a second? Motion and a second. Any comments, questions? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Commissioner meetings typically occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham.
The first Monday meeting begins at 9:30 a.m. and the third Monday meeting begins at 6:30 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting will be broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about their schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/AlamanceCountyNC or by clicking the YouTube link on the county website. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of this meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about the commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.